and things like that. You know, and I said to him, "You got. I don't think that there'll be that many people interested. You know, when your son tries to sell them, you know, you've got to sell them while you've got an audience that's wealthy enough and active enough to want to buy them. You know, I that's what I believe. That's the rational thought. Now, whether, in fact, irrationality will take over." To be seen, but somehow I don't think so.
In memorabilia terms, I think you're right. I do think you're right because I've got Sex Pistols Acetate of Anarchy on Abbey Road, and it's sitting there, and you go, okay, and I phoned that record collector, and they go, oh, 400 quid, and you go, piss off, it's worth £5,000.
Yeah,
because somebody at the moment will pay £5,000 yeah. for it. Interviews, funnily enough, I think are the story of the business. I actually think is different because it transcends collecting. And I know quite a lot of people that collect posters or collect this or collect that, and that's one thing. But if you look at it and you go, you know, here we go, Diamond Jubilee. So what do? They trot out all the footage from whenever. And in that respect, I think it becomes.
I agree. I think you're probably right on that. That we need all the history put down on film and on tape or whatever. So you're probably right. You know, there was a fantastic British music boom in from 1960 to 1995 or something. And it was world-beating. And I don't think it'll happen quite like that again. And therefore, I suppose it should be documented as much as possible. And as you say, the artists are well-documented.
Yeah, they get interviewed, and quite right, if they get interviewed endlessly.
But... Yeah, and often, you know, they don't have the real... a proper view of what the industry was all about anyway.
And you know. You can remember the 60s, you weren't there anyway.
Yeah, there's a whole load of that. The other thing I found, I do quite a lot of interviews, and the one thing that I've realised is that things happen to me that at the time that they happened was just part of doing a day's job. And in fact, while these things were happening, I was thinking, bloody hell, I've got to get to the post office because the missus said, if I don't post that bloody parcel today, you know, she'll have my guts for garters and I've got to get home by 8 o'clock because I promised the kids that da 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 da, right? And, I've got to phone the dentist because next week I'm... Right? And while I'm... And some really historical, important thing is going on that 20 years' time, somebody says, what did you do when this was going on? Right? And you know, actually, I can't remember because actually I did the most mundane things while this cacophony was all bubbling around. So when you're in the middle of it, right, actually you don't see it as something historic. It's just another bloody painful day. It's one of those days where you went home and you said, bloody load of shit happened today, right? But of course that was historic, you know. And that's the kind of weird sort of thing. you know, like taking the Clash down to see Glyn Johns, the famous record producer who did the Eagles and all this kind of thing. You know, really taking the Clash to a different level, right? I mean, this was like making Clash Americana, this was. And I took them all down to the fucking Glyn Johns' house, and he lived in this beautiful house mansion down in Surrey somewhere with a gated drive, long gated drive. And we got to the gate and we got out of our car to open the gate, and he rode down on a fucking horse. He rode down on horseback. Well, you can imagine what they thought. And he's so pompous, and he's very, very tough, Glyn Johns. And he's boss. He's a real boss. And, you know, he kind of looked down at him from the horse, you know, and you're thinking, you know, what are they sussing out about this guy? And he was saying things like, you know, I'm not going to stand any nonsense from you guys. You know, if you're going to start playing around doing this, I said, you listen to me. I know what I'm doing. And I'm just sort of edging back, you know, and I think, oh my God. But, you know, the interesting thing was, of course, he was so strong and so pointed that they actually liked him. Right, in the end, they kind of muttered and wondered. I can't remember we ever went in the house in the end. I think the whole meeting took place at the gate and he was on the horse. I can't remember going into the house at all because I can remember the frontage, but I can't remember the house. So I don't think we went in. The whole meeting was done at the bloody gate and we went home again. As it happened, we couldn't work with him. They were prepared to have a go with him in the end. I was still kind of going, go on, give it a try as we were going back. But they did like him. I thought they were going to lynch him. But they actually really liked him. And he would have been ideal for them. And so in the end, it didn't happen because his schedules didn't work with their schedules. But this was all about, you know, they were massive in the UK. And the Americans couldn't get them going properly. They did in the end, but they couldn't get them going properly. And, you know, they were saying to me, you've got to find another way. You know, their stuff would sound like classic rock and roll, you know, if it had, you know, proper production values. So that was the idea, to cut an album that was really more American. And as it happened, it didn't work out. But, you know, all that was, right, was a bloody painful day where you drove all the way down there with this bunch of moaning bastards, you know, and all the way back trying to convince them to improve their career. And, you know, you're dragging them through mud. And you get home and all he says, bloody awful day that was, you know, and you want to forget it, you know. Gary, you've got somebody really nice to deal with tomorrow, like Barbara Dixon. So, oh, at least I can speak to Barbara and have a nice cup of tea. You know, I mean, it's like... And those kind of things become the great sort of stories and the things that, you know, people that write their books and stuff want to know about, you know.
But it's only ever in retrospect, isn't it? You never yeah. know it at the time. Well, yeah.
Are you taking this stuff?
It's running, don't worry.
All right, that's better that you are, because...
I gather that's why I put the mic on and let you... I remember going on the Sex Pistols boat trip, and I do remember thinking, oh, this is interesting. that was one where I did actually consciously clock the moment, although at the end of it, when it all started to kick off, I thought, and now I'm going home, because, you know... I really don't need it, sort of thing. But most of it just goes, just, you know, it's what you did, isn't it? It's what you did. It was your life. That
yeah.
was your work. And
yeah.
just, you know, and everybody else is sitting around afterwards going, oh, you did so-and-so. And I'm thinking, oh, I don't know, did I? I can't, you know.
Yeah, it is.
I do so-and-so.
It's...
I normally start with what's the first record you bought. So did you buy records or were you, did your father have more than... you want to tell me how what the roots were?
Yeah, I don't think my dad had a lot of kind of big band dance records like Ted Heath and stuff like that, because he was a saxophonist, and he played in the Midlands in big bands and in bands. So that was the sort of music in our house. I think the first record I bought, I think, was Little Richard or something like that, an EP, Little Richard EP, which I'd heard at the local boys' club, because in those days, you know, you just went to boys' clubs. That was the only entertainment there was, you know. You played football, and you joined the football boys club or the scouts, and that was it, you know. So that was, I think, the first record that I bought. But I also, my dad, well, my younger brother Steve was already playing the piano and going to piano lessons. He started when he was about 3 or 4, and I was messing around playing a little bit. But my dad had found an old banjo in the shed, and skiffle was going on and stuff like that, and so I kind of got into a little skiffle group, and then trad jazz came along, and having a banjo was really useful, and so I was playing a banjo in these sort of trad jazz bands, and we used to again play all the sort of boys clubs and things like that. And then my brother joined in with me when he was about 16, and just as his voice broke, we were really into Ray Charles and all that kind of early rock and roll stroke rhythm and blues. And as his child voice broke, he moulded it into this wonderful kind of almost black sounding voice, unconsciously, really. So there he was, you know, from a child, you know, 4 weeks later, when he had a man's voice, it sounded like Ray Charles. It was amazing. And we played together in a band, and we started to put the Ray Charles numbers in the little trad jazz band thing. And of course, people started to talk about it. And then we met Spencer Davis, who was a folk singer who did blues songs. And at Birmingham University, when we were playing a gig there, and I don't know how we got round to it, but afterwards talking, we decided we'd get together and do blues together. So Spencer Davis and Steve and I used to do a little blues thing, and then a drummer from Birmingham University joined us, Pete York, on and off, and that's how we started a group called the Rhythm and Blues Quartet, we called ourselves. And before we knew it, everywhere we played, we'd turn up with our hacked old equipment. This was only in the Birmingham area, of course, and because Steve was still at school, and Spencer was still at university, and Pete York was still at university. And everywhere we played, we would turn up at 6 o'clock to some pub or some little club somewhere, and there'd be queues down the street. It was unbelievable. And everywhere we were playing was packed to the rafters. And we realised that we were doing something that everybody really wanted to hear. And it wasn't long before people in Leicester and Derby and Wolverhampton and all the surrounding areas. So all of a sudden, my brother wasn't turning up for school because we were playing till 1 o'clock. We weren't getting home till 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning and stuff. It got a bit out of hand, really. But we were making this fantastic living, and before long, we'd all bought little minivans and things, and we'd all bought new equipment, and we were a totally democratic four-piece. We didn't have a manager, you know. I used to take the bookings, and Spencer used to take the bookings. And we were still called the Rhythm and Blues Quartet. And we were playing in a central Birmingham club at the time. And Millie Small was playing at Birmingham Town Hall. She just had a massive hit with My Boy Lollipop. And she'd been brought to Britain by a young man called Chris Blackwell. And he was with her that night, and he said to somebody, which is typical Chris Blackwell, you know, is there any action in this town, you see? You know, is there anybody any good we can go see? And somebody said, you've got to see this Rhythm and Blues Quartet, they're fantastic. So he came down to this club after Millie Small had finished and saw us and fell in love with us and wanted to manage us. And we would have been he wanted us to be his first white British group, because he managed quite a lot of Jamaican reggae artists, including Jimmy Cliff and Jackie Edwards and Millie Small and people like that. And his whole business was selling reggae records to the British Jamaican contingent. And I always remember him telling us that it was a fantastic business. He said, "Do you know what?" He said, "You get a house with about five Jamaican families all living in the same house." He said, "And when they've got a favourite record, they all buy it." He said, "The household doesn't buy one. All five sets of families buy their copy." And I always stuck in my mind, you know, what a businessman. And anyway, he became our manager. And when we had to change our name, because the Rhythm and Blues Quartet wasn't a good enough name, he wanted us to, have a name like the Beatles, like these are some kind of animal type name or insect type name, and we hated that thought. And because Spencer Davies had such an interesting name, and he also loved being the front man in terms of doing interviews and everything, and we just wanted to stay in bed, we hated interviews. So in a mad rush, we said, "We're going to call ourselves the Spencer Davies Group," and that's what we called ourselves, which was odd at the time, because all the other groups were the somethings. So in a way, we had somebody's name as our group, and it kind of worked for us. And in fact, we played a lot when we were in London with a lot of the Jamaican artists, and that's how we got to know people like Jimmy Cliff and stuff, and Jackie Edwards, who was a very popular artist in London in the early 60s. He wrote "Keep On Running" for us. And which was our first number one hit record.
What sort of clubs were you playing in London then? What venues did you... So in Birmingham you're playing boys' clubs, and then you're playing pubs, and you're playing
then,
clubs?
Clubs. It moved to drinking clubs and things like that as it progressed. When we got signed to Blackwell and he put us with a London agent, we kind of got on the sort of top circuit. So we were playing all the famous clubs of the 60s, you know, the Manor House, the Eel Pie Island, the obviously the Marquee and all those kind of places. So and again, all around the country, you know, the Go-Go Club in Newcastle where the Animals started, and of course the Cavern in Liverpool we played many times. So it was we were on that circuit then, that was, you know, a really kind of hot circuit.
And what sort of equipment have you got at this stage?
Oh, no foldback. So we had our own PA speakers, very small speakers, and small 30 watt amps. All the amps were 30 watt amps. The drums weren't mic'd. And we had a PA system which we control from the stage, and we couldn't hear ourselves. So, but when you play seven nights a week, you don't need to hear each other. You know exactly what you're all doing, you know. So.
Ooh, hello, ferocious dog. Hello. Good morning. So, okay.
Yeah,
that's all right.
This is my wife Zoom.
Hello,
this is Mark.
Hello. Come on, dog. I can't smell that interesting. Oh, maybe I do.
Come on. Sorry. It's all right. It's no problem.
It's not a problem. So you've got? Have you got Vox equipment? Have you got WEM equipment? Have you got Marshall?
We got Vox. We had Vox equipment reasonably well. We all split, I think. We had different types of, and Burns. We had, well, I think Steve had a Burns amp. I had a Vox amp, and then a Marshall. I had one of the very first Marshall bass amps, but it wasn't a stack. It was just one speaker. And Spencer often had a Vox amp, I think. So we probably had, I think our PA speakers were Burns speakers, and they may later have been WEM speakers. I can't remember.
So I became obsessed with equipment makers at one stage, realising that this was about 5 years before Jim Marshall died, suddenly going, oh my word, I've never thought of equipment makers, let's go and do.
Yeah.
And Jim, I never got to film, funnily enough, because he'd had I spent a lot of time trying to, and he'd had a stroke by then.
So it
was too late, which proved everything that I thought to myself about, you know, getting people before it's, there you go. So did you play the flamingo?
Oh, yes, of course. Absolutely. Oh, yes, yeah. And also I remember down in South London, we played a couple of the Cray Twins clubs. And those clubs were amazing. I tell you what, we got ripped off by a few people. We never, ever got ripped off by the Crays, right? They paid cash on the nail, right? The moment you walked off stage, no problems at all. You know, and it's wonderful, isn't it? And you'd go to some places around the country and some guy would say, don't worry, I'm sending the check to your agent. It's going to cause it never, ever came, you know. And there's the wonderful Crays, you know, who were, their business was impeccable. And there was never any problem. God, problems. Gigs were extraordinary then. That in the early 60s, I mean, you used to get a lot of violence in these places, mainly kind of sort of mods and rockers type punch-ups. You know, I mean, we did Margate in Bank Holiday and all that stuff, you know, and driving our van down the front and there's thousands of rockers pouring down on bikes and thousands of mods pouring down on scooters. And you think, bloody hell, you know, what's going to happen to us in the middle of all this? And you play the Dreamland Ballroom in Margate, you know, and they'd all turn. I mean, how they control these things. And there was fights and punch ups all the time. And you never had proper security. We had one road manager. And we used to get out of these problems by, if they attacked us, which often we were attacked, right? And usually the perpetrators would push one of their mates to come up and confront the band, you know, and laugh at it, you know. Go on, you tell them, you know, you tell them, Harry, you tell them how crap they are. So this guy would come on stage, you know, all, you know, the lads are down below, there's going, go on, get them. And he'd come on, and we'd go, and we'd work this out, and we'd go, he wants to sing, you know. And of course, all his mates, right, who'd send him up to wallop us, you know, and all go, yeah, let him. And we could play anything. We could play, Steve, of course, could play anything to start with, you know, and we could play, and we could say, what do you want to sing? And some guy, some evil-looking heathen, actually said, I want to sing Lipstick on Your Collar. And I remember we played Lipstick on Your Collar, and the guys in the front were falling about. And we found that was the only way. It's the classic, the band has to play on when there's a fight. And I always remember going to Elgin in North Scotland. And when we got to the venue, there was a great fence up in front of the stage. Right. So and we couldn't get there at 4 o'clock in the afternoon or whatever it might be to set up and everything. And you walk in, you think, what do they need this for? You know, who is going to come to this gig? And of course, When you start the gig, you realise, you know, that a bunch of completely stoned out, drunken out people who never, you know, never go to it. This was their local monthly dance, and they were out to lose it, you know. And they were frightening experiences, you know. But you had to deal with these things because you couldn't kind of run away and call security. There was no such thing. And all of those gigs were similar like that. Once you got out of the normal kind of cool venues that there were in the major cities, you know, you then went out into areas of the country, you know, which were very behind the eight ball as far as what was fashionable and what was happening. And, you know, you had to deal with it musically. As well as everything else. If you didn't, you know, they'd throw things at you.
And I remember going to a gig up in the valleys in Wales and trying to work out why the bar was 5 foot high. You just looked at this and went, why is that bar so high? And then you realise it's so nobody can jump over
it
and all of that, you know. And the staff were just handing down 2 litre bottles that they'd refill with cider or beer. You know, you brought your own 2 litre plastic, but this was later, 70s. You know, you'd hand your empty 2 litre bottle up and they would fill it up and pass it back down to you. And all the girls wore black miniskirts and white blouses. And I just thought, I've never been anywhere like this before in my life. It's extraordinary. I'd hated the band, you know, that I'd realised within 2 minutes of having gone that I'd gone to see, you know.
Oh, yeah, well, I've done that lots of times.
You then must have been, it must have been Brave New World. You must never have seen anything like it, presumably.
No, and keeping on that kind of gigs in the 60s, the other extraordinary thing was touring in Northern Ireland, where we couldn't understand when we saw our little itinerary that we were playing 2 shows a day, right? And we'd done that plenty of times. You usually did that on a Saturday quite a lot in Britain. You know, you'd play a gig up till midnight, then you'd play another gig starting at 1 o'clock in the morning in another venue, right? But in Northern Ireland, we were doing one at 6 o'clock and another one at 9 o'clock, you know, different venues. Of course, it wasn't until we got there that we realised that we were playing to segregated audiences. We'd play to Catholics in one and Protestants in another. And it was just totally ununderstandable to us. You know, it was just a complete nonsense. And that's exactly what we did. We played to segregated audiences in Great Britain. Amazing, isn't it? Amazing.
And we criticise the Americans for having segregated.
I know. Yeah, it is extraordinary. Yeah,
I've never come across that before.
Oh yeah. And I'm sure all the bands did it. And I'm sure if you ask the Who and you know Eric Burden and all these people, if they can remember, they'd tell you the same. But it was extraordinary. That extraordinary. Yeah.
So did you go to America as Spencer Davis at all?
No, we didn't. We broke up just before our big American tour, although we had 2 number 1 hits in America. Give Me Some Loving and I'm a Man. But we decided, Steve and I both decided to leave. Steve was getting disillusioned. And I was getting very disillusioned too. We played 7 nights a week. We used to have to book a day off 3 months in advance. You know, it was ridiculous. And constant travelling, up and down, you know. And we often drove ourselves. By this time, we'd all bought nice cars and the van would go off to the gig, wherever it was. And all 4 of us, or at least we'd go in 3 cars if we didn't go in 4 cars, we'd all travel separately. Extraordinary. I mean, there was no disharmony within the band, but we all had different things to do and in the day, if you like. And Steve had his own friends and I had my own friends and things. And so we'd say, well, we had to be at the venue by 5 o'clock, and so you get there at 5 o'clock. We found the Spencer moved to London, which was fine because he could do all the promotion for the band. But the other three of us stayed in Birmingham, because Birmingham was the centre of the country, and it was so much quicker to get to Newcastle or Stoke-on-Trent or Manchester and stuff. So we stayed in Birmingham, three of us, and Spencer moved to London. But of course we were doing a lot of work in London, but it was easier to travel.
Any motorway or any of that? Though?
Well, that's right. There wasn't much motorway then. The M1 started at Coventry and ended at the Busy Bee at Watford. And eventually there was a bit of M6 that went to Manchester. That started, I think, at Wolverhampton and went up just south of Manchester, to where Manchester Airport sort of is now. And that was it. Those were the only bits of motorway there were.
So then you bought yourself nice cars to travel in then?
The Triumph Vitesses, which were wonderful motor cars. And you could turn them on a sixpence. They were wonderful. Steve and I had a Triumph Vitesse each. And I can't remember what Spencer and Pete had. But, we would travel separately to gigs, but we were playing constantly. And then we kind of broke up. So the Spencer Davies group had, we had four top two records. I think three of them were number one, one was number two. We had two albums that were number one albums. And then that was all in really a space of only about 4 or 5 years. And then Steve and I split, and Steve formed Traffic.
And so just before we finish on Spencer, so what was, do you know, can you remember what your royalty rates were or anything like that?
Oh, they're still the same now. So, yeah, I can remember what they are. Yeah, oh, no, that we share 4%, I think. Yeah, so we get a percent each. But to be fair, over the years, Steve has managed to negotiate it up. Not a lot, but a little bit. So we get a little more now. And he managed to negotiate it up because we can't get the material away from Universal. But Universal have realised that it makes sense to play the game with us, because we'll be helpful if we can get a little money out of it. So they've given us a slightly better deal now.
4% at the time was possibly not a bad rate.
It was all right.
It was 2%.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Or as Hank Marvin, not as Hank, as Bruce Welch puts it, 2% split four ways.
That's right. Well, this was 4% split four ways, yeah. Yeah, oh, yeah. Yeah, that's what it was. And it was in perpetuity. So there was no way of ever getting it back. So, and it's still the same.
And publishing? How much of the material was written by the band?
Quite a bit. We wrote two very big hits, Give Me Some Lovin', which, I mean, is used now on an advert for some yogurt drink or something, and I'm a Man. Three of us co-wrote Give Me Some Lovin', a couple wrote I'm a Man, so various people in the band wrote various songs. But Jackie Edwards had written the first hit, because we were struggling to find, we hadn't written a song that worked to break us in the first place. And Jackie Edwards wrote this song, and it sounded really good. And I remember recording it, and you know, it's very interesting. It helped me a lot in my future life as an A&R man. We went to Phillips Records. This would be about 63. And this really was a time when people in record companies wore suits. I mean, it's a joke that, I mean, they're called the suits, but they haven't wore suits for 30 years. But in the 60s, they did. They wore suits. And the guys that worked in the recording studios wore white coats, which is the other extraordinary thing. Anyway, we went to see the A&R man with our Keep On Running record, which we'd recorded. And he listened to it and he said, do you know what? He said, this is a good song. He said, but it's got no intro. It's got nothing of interest to make you stop what you're doing and go, what's this? You know, he said, if only it had a proper interesting intro, then it would work. And we, of course, went out of there thinking, you know, what does he know? Who the hell's he? You know, this bloke sitting there with a suit telling us what to do. He's got no clue. And Blackwell said, well, we've got to try. He said, look, have a go, see what you can do, and don't worry, he said, if it doesn't really work, I'll talk him round. You know, so we went in the studio, and I always remember that somebody had given Spencer the first fuzz box that had been made in America to fuzz guitar sounds, and it was called the Big Muff. And my nickname is Muff. And so we were laughing about this thing called the Big Muff. So I plugged it in to my bass. It was for guitars, but I plugged it into my bass. And I played my bass with it, and it made this fantastic sound, you see. So I worked out a silly little bass line. And the guy said, well, hang on, let's try that in the front of this Keep On Running song. So we did that. And Blackwell heard it. He said, hey, he said, that sounds really good. It's so interesting a sound. Nobody's ever heard a sound like that before. Of course, we took it back to the A&R man. And he said, that, you see, is exactly what I was telling you. You know, and I kind of, I always remembered that, because there were many, many times in the future where I was going to have to do very similar things to other musicians. And I knew how I felt at the time, when I was told, you know, and how I realised that give it a go, because the guy might be right, you know, and it can work in your favour. And so it helped me a lot as an A&R man, realising that, you know, I'd been one of those people that hated everybody in the record company, thought they were all wankers, and they all did wear suits. And as far as I was concerned, they knew nothing about the music that I knew about. And little did I know that I was going to be one of them for the rest of my life.
It's funny, it's like I left to manage a group, I left because I knew everything there was to know. You know, I went off managing a group and learnt more in the next 18 months than I would ever have believed possible, because you just did your bit and you knew it, you know. You were so clever and so good and all the rest, and then you learnt and you went. And if you were bright, you learnt. And if
that's
you
right.
weren't bright, you didn't listen to what was going on around you. And
that's absolutely
and
true.
And all the rest of it. And it is funny. So you, so the band break up.
Chris Blackwell asked me to. He just started his fledgling Island Records.
Let's just try not to do that. Catch that on that. Right, I was just making sure the sound was all right. So sorry. Start again.
When the group broken up. Well, before it had broken up, and we told Chris Blackwell we were going to break up, Steve and I. Blackwell, being the clever bloke that he was, he didn't want to lose any of us. So he wanted Steve's new group and was prepared to help Steve put that together. And he wanted me to be a part of his new record label, that he was just forming, which was called Island Records. So I went into Island Records with Blackwell, David Betteridge, who used to take care of all the selling of the records, and Guy Stevens, who was this lunatic DJ who we'd met many times before as the Spencer Davis Group, who was totally nutty but fantastically lovable, and knew everything there was to know about American soul music, rhythm and blues. And Island Records kind of started that way, and we all sat around a little table and ran a record company like that. And I learned so much because we didn't know what we had to do. And I was delegated to go to the BBC when we made a record because I knew BBC record producers, because we'd been booked on TV and radio as the Spencer Davis Group. So I knew some of these people and they knew who I was. So I was delegated to phone up these people and say, could I come and play you our latest record that we've made for Ireland? So for a couple of years, I did a lot of that. And I also, because I knew all the agents and the promoters around the country, I did a lot of the booking of traffic and stuff like that. So I did a lot of virtually all that for Island Records, which was a fantastic grounding for my knowledge of the business, because I learned how to buy and sell acts. You know, how you did that out in the countryside, as far as selling acts onto gigs is concerned, and how much you can charge and how much you can get paid up front, and how you chase the money if it doesn't come, and how you plot a tour so that the guys in the band don't have to keep driving backwards and forwards and backwards. Well, they still did, but you know, you try to plot a tour carefully, and at the same time do the media, particularly the broadcast media, going to the BBC and trying to get people, you know, on the old grey whistle test or Top of the Pops or whatever else it was. Local television, in those days, you could get pop bands on Spotlight in Manchester and whatever the one in Newcastle and Birmingham were. And you know, you could organise that when your band was playing in that area, you could get them on at 6 o'clock in the evening and play. And, you know, I would organise things like that. So I learnt a lot about the promotional side, which was very humbling. And I realised that there was a worse job in music, and that was the job of the plugger. They have the worst job in the whole of the music industry. And I take my hat off to those people, because they get kicked around from both sides. They go into the radio stations and the television stations, and the people give them short shrift and say, don't like it, it's not for me, no, take it away, don't want it, don't play me again, it's really wasting my time, go away. So you get back and the artist says to you, you're no bloody good because you can't get my record played. So they get it both ends of the stick, and it's a tough, tough, tough job, that is. It's the toughest job of the lot. And I'm glad I did that because I learned a lot about how you deal with promotion people and how you make bands understand the process of their promotion once they've made the record, you know. And so it was an interesting thing. And all of us in Island Records on those early days of 1969 into 1970, which is our first years, we all were learning on our feet, just like you'd said that you did. We just learnt on our feet about how you made records and how you sold them and how you promoted them.
It seems to be a current, a consistent theme all the way through the development of the British music industry, that everybody's making it up as they go along and everybody's learning it as they go along. There are no classes, there are no rules, there are no universities teaching endless subjects about how to do it. Everybody learned it as they went along.
Yeah, that's true, but they were on a wave. You couldn't, even if there was a college of pop, you know, you wouldn't have had time to go to it, right? Because by the time you'd been to it, the initiative would have passed you by. The opportunity that's lying there for tomorrow morning would have gone. There was so much happening that you couldn't take your eye off the ball. You just had to deal with it and get on with it. So you couldn't go away and learn something, you know. You just got to deal with it. So, and that was the momentum of the business. And I dare say that when you go into the gaming, the computer gaming industry, and the writing of all these computer games and the artistic direction of all these computer games, I bet you find exactly the same thing happened 10, 20 years ago when these guys were all just doing it the best they could and working out how to sell it.
Oh, I think there's a distinct parallel with that business these days, or in the last period, and the music business in the 60s, 70s. I think, you know, the computer game thing, it absolutely is totally parallel.
Yeah, it is.
You know, you look at a 14-year-old kid now, and what are they interested in? They're interested in computer games. They're not interested in music in the way that it was. It was so fundamental, wasn't it, when we were kids? Music was the be-all and end-all. It was what everybody did, what everybody was interested in. And you look at it, you know, a friend of mine's got, you know, 14-year-old kid, and what do? They're interested in computer games.
Yeah. You know? There is a difference. And the difference is with the music industry, it was sexier. Because real people were in front of you. You know, with computer games, the real people are hidden in the background writing these games and designing these games, and they are a nobody in the background. But in the music industry, there were stars, there were people that you could look at and look up to and fantasize about and whatever else. So I think it's different.
There are lots of differences. Yeah.
The way you get the business up and running, yes, it was. But then there were many things like that in the '60s. You know, the fashion industry was similar.
Yeah, it's a period of social change that is so pronounced.
Yeah,
the baby boomers and all the reasons that we historically know why it's happened, but it is an extraordinary period of change and the like of which you probably don't see again, because...
No, you won't. I mean, I, you know, my son works in the music industry and he's very successful. He works in music publishing, but he doesn't earn anything like I earned all those years ago doing a similar job, right? Because now, if you were doing his job in, if you were doing my son's job in the 70s and the 80s, you would be one of the best paid people in the country, right? Now, it's just an ordinary job, you know, where you struggle to pay the mortgage and struggle to buy your food for the week and pay your gas and electricity like everybody else. But when I was doing it, right, I had no friends who were possibly earning what I was earning. Nobody. Because I was in the the area of business that was booming, that was greater than any other booming industry, and even though during the 60s, I mean, there were periods in between, but in the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, there was a kind of a full employment type thing. The 70s had a big dip, I know, but you know, social history, you know, there was a full employment for teenagers, and but you know, I was a top earner. And I wasn't a pop star. This was a bloke who worked in a record company. We, all of us, were top earners. You know, we earned the top wage that you could earn, really, in the country. And so it was very, very, we were extraordinarily lucky, because my son isn't any better than I am. Sorry, isn't any worse than I am or better than I am. And he can't earn that money anymore.
But it's timing, isn't it? And do you want to answer? Yeah, no, it's times are times, and it's just whatever at the. So Island Records, when it starts, there's four of you.
Four or five,
and how many? And how many acts do you sign to start with?
We started with Traffic. Who was next?
I've just got this blur because I bought them all. This set of pink labels, I just kept buying you all the Blood Wind Pigs and Spooky
Yeah,
Teeth.
Yeah, that's right. Well, we started with Traffic, and then we signed reasonably quickly Jethro Tull through Terry Ellis, and Free, and Cat Stevens, and Fairport Convention through, who was brought in by their manager.
Is it Joe Lustig?
No.
Is it Joe Boyd?
Thank you.
Right.
Yeah, Joe Boyd bought in Fairport Convention, and those were the key early acts that really gave Ireland that feel and sound.
Is worrying because I think I bought all of those at the time as well.
They were all great records.
I think I'm 8 years younger than you, sort of thing, and it's just that classic, you know, I was your market, and it's just, you know, what you did. And so how long did you stay at Ireland for?
Till about 76, so I've been there about 7 or 8 years. I just thought of I have told this story before, but it's an interesting story. I just thought of, we were talking about radio and TV. And we'd struggled with Free to... made a couple of albums with Free, and we built them up on the road, and they were doing very well on the road, and they were a very well respected kind of blues band. Alexis Corner brought Free to us, and finally on the third album they cut All Right Now. They cut All Right Now. And the moment that we all heard it, it was like, wow, this is a killer, killer record. And so we made the record, and, you know, Muff, you know all those people up at the BBC. You take that record up there, they're going to love this. And, of course, I was well certain that they were. And I took the record up, and the very first person I played it to said, "We can't play this." And I said, "Why?" And he said, "Listen to the words. It says on the second verse, we pay the fucking rent." And I said, "Does it?" He said, "Yeah, listen. I played it back and we pay the fucking rent." And I said, "Oh my God, I didn't realise." So I went back and they said, "No, here's the lyrics," right? And it was about, the second verse was about on their London street, and at the time they just put in parking meters, and what the verse said was something about you park your car and you pay the parking rate, but it sounded like you paid the fucking rent, but it was paid the parking rate. So emboldened, I went back to the BBC and I said, "Here's the words. I took down, look, it's parking rate," right? And they said, "No, it's fucking rent." So I went round every single producer of all of the Radio 1 shows and said, "Listen to this record. It's fantastic." And they all said, "We can't play it because it says fucking in it." And I said, "Honestly, here's the words." So I went back. So I was walking out of Egton House, which is where Radio 1 was, and coming from one of the end offices that I'd never, ever been in before, there was some kind of, I don't know, it was Miles Davis was blasting out or something, and I'd had such a terrible day, I didn't know what I was going to do. What was I going to tell Chris Blackwell? What was I going to tell the guy? The greatest record I'd ever heard, and I can't get anybody to play it. So I wandered past this office, and I kind of wandered in. And I thought, I'll sit and listen to a bit of Miles Davis. That'll calm me down. And it was the office of the BBC Jazz Club, right, which ran on BBC Two or whatever it was. And the guy who was the producer of BBC Jazz Club was a guy called Teddy Warwick. And he said, "What's the matter with you?" So it looks as though somebody's died. And I said, "I can't." I said, "I don't know what I'm going to do." I said, "I've got the best record I've ever had in my life, and nobody will play it. I can't go back and tell him. I don't know what I'm going to do." He said, "Let's hear it." So the Miles Davis record came off the player, and he stuck on "All Right Now." And he said, "It's unbelievable." He said, "It's fantastic." And I said, "But what about the..." He said, "Leave it to me. Give me the lyrics." Right. And he said, "Just leave it to me." Right. He said, "I'll get this played for you." And the rest is history. Right. Teddy Warwick, who was head of jazz, right, went round and battered all those guys in the pop end to play "All Right Now." And the record became a monster hit. And, you know, it's... and those kind of things, those are the sort of things that happened on a daily basis that you didn't think meant anything at the time, right, but were key moments. And yet, all you thought to yourself was, "Oh, no, not yet, but we get our post late, so it might come today."
I
certainly was a Gordon Brown moment, wasn't it?
Quality bit there. Right, so you leave Ireland in the middle of the 70s. Why do you leave? Well, have you been producing there? Or
yeah. At Ireland, when Sparks came to us, I tried, when we signed them, I tried to get three or four producers to produce them. And at this time, Sparks were a very weird, wacky act with a very strange sound. with a kind of clanking keyboard type sound, whereas, you know, at the time, you know, there was a lot of, you know, guitar based stuff, and I couldn't get anybody to produce them. I tried 3 or 4, 5 people, and in the end I said to them, look, let's go in the studio together and try and make a kind of demo in how we think that this is should sound, and then I'll get a much better opportunity of getting a producer to understand where we're coming from. And we went into the studio, and we realised when we went into the studio, we put a little band together, a guitarist and a drum, English guys, the moment we started to cut some stuff, we realised it was fantastic. So we carried on and cut a whole album and cut this song, This Town Ain't Big Enough for Both of Us, which was a massive hit. So I'd suddenly become a producer, you know, by default, really. And I got asked by quite a lot of people to produce them. And I did various production stuff, and sometime later I was chasing up this band called Dire Straits to see if I could sign them for Ireland, and in fact I was behind the eight ball. I thought that I'd got in there and got them, and in fact they just done a deal with Mercury or Philips Phonogram, and I spoke to the manager, and he said, well, you've missed out, mate, you know, you got it, you know. And he said, actually, he said, we've been thinking about producers and we wanted somebody who could look at it from a different angle. Would you like to produce them? And I said, well, you know, I work for Island Records, and so I went to Blackwell and said, look, you know, he'd heard the band because I played them to him, you know, and he said, you know, yeah, you know, let's chase them up and stuff. And I said, look, you know, but they've offered to produce them, and I really feel they've got something, and I'd like to have a go. And he said, look, if you record the album in our studios, in Ireland studios, so at least all the studio costs and everything else go to Ireland, you know, you can take 2 weeks off or whatever it was, 2 or 3 weeks off, and you'll be working in the building anyway, and you can record them. He could have easily said no, and he said yeah. And I persuaded the guys that the Island Studios was the best place to record. And so I produced their album. And it took a long time before that album took off. It was, 6 months after it came out before it started to happen. And in that meantime, I'd been pulled by Morris Oberstein, who ran CBS, because I'd produced an album for them, which wasn't very successful. It was an album they'd signed Russ Ballard, the songwriter, and they wanted to make an album. We made a really, really good album, and loads of people went and covered the songs off it, but his performances never made it. And they were so thrilled with this album when I delivered it. I think Oberstein had said, you know, this is the ideal kind of guy to run our A&R department. And so just after I'd finished recording with Dire Straits, I got this call to meet Morris Oberstein. And to be fair, they offered me a very, very good deal. And I went to Blackwell and said, look, you know, what am I supposed to do? You know, and he's a deal maker in every sense, and you know, he kind of said, I can't match this, you know. And so I said, well, it looks like I'm going to have to go. And so I went to CBS and I ran their UK A&R department. And the first two acts that were dumped on me, right, you know, we've got two new signings and we don't know what we're going to do with them, right? One was The Clash and the other was Shaking Stevens. Okay, you know, how far apart could this be? You know, but in a way, I had all the tools to deal with all this and I could deal with both of them. You know, it was, I think The Clash, yeah, I mean, I was kind of, I had to go meet Bernie Rhodes, and I realised once I met Bernie Rhodes, you know, how difficult life was going to be for the next few years, because he was a real character, and he needed careful handling, and then you had Shaking Stevens on completely the other side, who was a whole different kettle of fish, but had his own problems too that you had to deal with. And you know, it was like a day's work really, but you know, somehow these things became successful. You had to do different types of things for one set of act that you would do to another. You can't do anything like the same, you know. The Clash didn't want your input the only way you could give your input to The Clash was subtly. You kind of suggested three or four things that they should do, and they would choose one of those three or four things, then it was their idea, which is fine. And Oberstein always used to say, it actually helps The Clash's persona, right, if we're the hated record company. He said, I don't care if they say in the NME that they hate us. He said, let's keep it up. He said, it's good for business. So don't worry about it. Let them hate us, you know. And so it was there was this wonderful love-hate relationship between The Clash and the record company. They used to call me Duff Windbag, I can always remember, like, when I'd walk into the studios, you know, there'd be dead silence when I walked in, you know, as if to say, who the hell's this person? How dare he impede on our territory, you know? And but that really, you know, they were just like lots of young, you know, angry musicians. But at the end of the day, they were fine musicians and, you know, really became, you know, great writers and musicians of their time. You had to give them, you know, a long lead. And really the thing to do was to make sure that everything around them worked properly, so that they could do what they wanted to do. And it was a matter of just keeping that whole thing in perspective and dealing with the manager correctly. And you know, we had lots and lots of issues about, you know, whether we should have double albums and all these kind of things. And which track should go on, because they'd often cut loads of tracks, and which track should go on the album, which shouldn't, and, you know, all these kind of things.
And did you proffer your advice and then they would decide what tracks they wanted on the album? Did you have did you have say in what ended up going on there?
Often you would make deals, but this wasn't necessarily just with the Clash. This would happen with a lot of acts where they would cut a track where, or they'd written a song even, where they would dismiss. And you'd say, hang on a minute, that's great. No, no, it's rubbish. We're not going to touch that. You know, it's too commercial. It's too poppy, or it was too something or other. But it's wonderful. You know, no, we're definitely not going to do it. So you'd say to them, well, you know, you'd have to find a deal. There'd be another song that you didn't like, and they were trying to push it onto you. And then you say, well, look, I'll let you do, you know, I'll let you have this song on the album, you know, as long as you cut this one. And really, those sort of silly little deals were made often with bands and artists. And bands and artists will tell you many years later how they were talked into cutting these tracks that ended up being the pinnacles of their career. And this happens across the board, from pop acts to rock acts. And that's kind of how it went on. You know, you sort of did these little studio deals all the time.
It's very hard for a band to be objective about its own material, isn't it?
Yeah, but it would never say so.
No.
It would never, ever say so, and that is the problem. And there was always four or five of them and one of you, you know, and you didn't really have much chance. And, of course, managers are always stuck in the middle, and often you needed very, very strong management to be able to sit the manager down and say, look, they're going off on the wrong tangent here. We need to pull them back. You know, very few managers were capable of actually managing their act, sitting the act down and saying, look, this is not right. This isn't right. And what we should do is that, you know.
Do you think that most of the quality of most of the managers wasn't good enough?
Well, most of the managers had to learn as they went along, and because there was no course in rock management, and usually most managers were mates of the band. You know, that's how they started, or they were the bloke's equipment before they became famous. You know, and so if you had an intelligent equipment humper before you came famous, then you were lucky, because he would probably get through as your manager. If you had an idiot equipment humper before you became famous and he became your manager, you were in trouble, you know.
So the classic sort of CBS period, did you get involved with replacing managers with bands, for bands?
Oh yeah, yeah, often, yeah, and replacing musicians. I mean, you know, there is no doubt that the successful bands, whoever you may want to pinpoint, usually there's one man in there who has a ruthless tendency. He's probably the leader. Even in a democratic band, there's the guy that's the leader, the sort of Mick Jagger type person. That you have to have that ruthlessness, because it's very rare that a sensational band of five musicians with a sensational manager all get together, right, and all at the same time and start off their careers. Very rare. Usually there's somebody that doesn't work in that organisation. And often they're very close friends. You know, they've been to school together, you know, or whatever it may be. And somebody has to say, look, he's not pulling his weight. He just doesn't make it. And I got used to having to do this. I did it with, you know, drummers or rhythm guitar players or backing singers or something or other, or tambourine players. You can't get rid of him, you know. He's been my mate since I was 4 years of age. But he just plays tambourine, for God's sake, you know. And you know, but mainly the big bands, whoever they may be, You'll see them all written down. They've got a guy in there who could do that. And you've got to do it. And, you know, and again, there were managers similarly where you had to pull the act aside and say, your manager isn't giving you the best advice, you know. And we will help you find another one, or we'll help you find an American manager, you know, and your mate, who's your manager now, can just run the UK, and this American guy can run the world or whatever. You know, we could work out ways of doing it and kind of keep the guy in, probably. And of course, there were many, many contractual problems that would occur here, you know, because often, you know, that they once they made a record deal, they got contracts with each other, you know, and so, you know, the contracts sometimes had to be sorted out. But I mean, I can't remember how many times when I'd audition acts, or, you know, go and see an act for the first time. What always sticks in my mind, where I auditioned this group. Normally I go out to gigs to see acts play, because that's the best way of seeing. But for some reason, this act came into our studios to play for me. And I always remember that I was some band from Manchester somewhere. And I could tell straight away, as soon as I spoke to the manager, and he was telling me about how they're doing things and what they wanted to do and how they saw themselves and all that. He was useless, completely useless manager. And I remember at the end of the audition, I pulled the girl to one side and I said, listen, you're really good, but I've got to give you some advice here. You've got to get rid of that guy. She said, he's my husband. Classic, you know, oh no. But, you know, that kind of thing happened, you know. But, you know.
Yeah, difficult, isn't it?
Yeah.
Go back to Ireland before I forget. What were the typical deals that were done, if there is any, in those early periods? What are the royalty rates that are getting paid?
Oh, they'd moved up from about 2% and 4% to about 6% and 8%. That was the kind of rates, and the maybe 10%, and the but, you know, everything was paid for.
I was going to say, are the recording costs recouped?
They were. Some of them weren't in those days, but once you started to get up to about the 10% range, they started to get recouped.
And this is in Basing Street again, so the studios, is it?
Yes. So
you're recording largely in your own studio.
That's right.
And Branson follows the model boy with the manor, yeah.
That's right, yeah. And the costs of the studios were deducted from the band's albums, yeah. But, you know, at the end of the day, you know, a band had, from a record company in those days, you know, fantastic platform to set themselves from. They didn't have to worry about the expensive costs of making records. And it was expensive then to make records. And you would have a van bought for you and a roadie paid for you and all this kind of thing. And in the early days, we would pay for those things because we were making enough money from the record royalties. Once the act was demanding higher royalties, which they soon did, then you needed to recoup some of the costs that you'd been paying out. So it's just, you know, it just kept that balance.
And when you're at CBS then, are you constrained by... are you allowed to pay what you want, or are you constrained by the American protocol of what people should be paid?
That's right. You were given, at CBS, where you had an American parent, you were given a good deal of... You would have a budget at the beginning of the year, so you'd have a pot of money to spend. And so you could spend that money how you liked, right? But you couldn't sign an act that was going to cost you more money than they would sign acts for, if you know what I mean. So there was a certain control, but it wasn't very it wasn't very restraining, really.
Did CBS America put out everything that CBS Britain wanted them to?
No, no. American companies, American owners of British companies would only put out, even if the British company signed an act for the world, the American company, when you made the record, could quite easily turn around and say, we don't like this. We don't want to put it out. And the act was stuck because it had signed a worldwide deal and the American company didn't want to release it and they couldn't get out of it. So, and as I say, this happened to the best of them, the best of them. You know, and what you had to do, you had to work with the American company, you had to get to understand the American market and what Americans liked. And you know, as I say, we had to do that with The Clash. In the end, the Americans put together the first two Clash albums. They put to, I can't remember exactly what they did. They mottled together a couple of the singles, the first singles, and some of the first album and some of the second album, and they made a whole different, you know, thing up for their market, and it came out a year after The Clash had got going in the UK, and we had that with many artists where we really had to, you know, the Americans would say, look, this is the best song on the album, but it really doesn't work in the way it's done, even though you've had a big hit with it in the UK. And we'd often go to an American producer or somebody like that and re-record it or add something to it, or, you know, open it up and mix it differently, or, you know, do things like that.
And did any of those ultimately work?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting.
I mean, these things did work, yeah. Yeah.
It's interesting because the EMI thing where, you know, Capital was passing on all the British acts in the 60s, which is just extraordinary when you look at it. And then I come back to, I think I was in America when they were doing new music seminars, and they were taking all these of the Duran Durans and the Seagulls and all these sorts of people and doing medleys of them for radio, because America just couldn't cope with anything as strangely sounding as they were. And, you know, then you realised a year later all these things were in the top 10 in America because the American taste had changed.
Yeah, well, that's right, you know, and you have to look at this thing sensibly. It's a massive, massive country. It takes a long time for things to eke into into the psyche. And this was quite new to them. It was, you know, it was very English. And you did have to choose exactly the right kind of stuff and take it to the right type of radio stations and build it carefully. It was an art form in itself, getting these records heard. And yeah, we did all that kind of stuff, doing medleys and you know, just the, you know, just the hooky bits of the song and cut out the verses and just have the choruses, all kinds of stuff, you know, to try and get, you know, the American radio stage just to catch the ear, you know, and then build it slowly from there. Yeah, it was an art form in itself.
Did you work on any of the acts that the British acts that go to America that I regard as becoming huge and going around hoovering the big money out of America, as whether the 10 Years After and the Humble Pies and the Jethro Tulls and all of the acts that become huge in America and go and play the Sheds. Were you involved with any of those? I'm trying to work out whether you're whether you're too early at Ireland.
Yeah, I was too early at Ireland.
And then you're CBS by...
Yeah, and I was still building things up at CBS.
And then you're working with British acts anyway, which...
Yeah. And my main object was to deal with Britain.
Yeah, the Clash would have... To a degree, that's a bit later.
Was later on.
Yeah.
And, you know, we had, with Sade and very, I mean, you know, somebody who's completely forgotten now, like Terence Trent D'Arby, you know, was massive in America, Paul Young. We had all those acts, but not in the period that you've just mentioned.
The rock acts, which
my brother's Traffic, along with Jethro Tull, who were both there at the beginning of Ireland, they eventually, you know, kind of did that. My brother slightly less, but in the same situation, you know, Traffic again were all over America. So we didn't really have one major UK act that was that kind of rock.
I think you're
Dire Straits, of course, did.
Oh, Dire Straits.
Yeah, but that wasn't a CBS act, but I'd still been involved in it.
Yeah. No, I'm just very interested in that. It's almost not the revenge of the British bands, but I'm just fascinated with that. I'm fascinated inevitably with this social progression where you get rhythm and blues groups and then you get the beat groups and, you know, you got skiffle and you get rhythm and blues and you got beat groups and you've got, and then this rock thing that suddenly completely takes the world over, and I find it really quite interesting, but you're straddling bits of that. Okay.
Yeah, so, I do remember one extraordinary thing. I was I'd taken while I was still at Ireland, so this would have been about early part of the 70s, about 73, 74, I was taking Joe Cocker across America. And we were doing really well with Joe. He'd done A Little Help from My Friends, which was a Beatles cover. And that's why the Americans loved it. And but he was a bizarre act, and they loved that too. And we were doing fantastic business all over America. And I was taking him over there, looking after him. And we were on the road with the band. And I remember it was my birthday, so it was in June, and the manager of Traffic and Joe Cocker threw a birthday party for me in Manhattan when we were in town, and somebody in this birthday party absolutely slammed me with LSD, and I was in a serious bad way. And I always remember the drummer of Joe Cocker walking me through New York all night long. I was in a complete, and it didn't really go away very much the next couple of days, and I felt really bad. Oh, they take me to a doctor and they poured all kinds of downers down me and stuff. And I'd got to go to this, with Joe, to this wacky rock festival up in Woodstock, right? And which was some new festival they were having. And in town and at the party was John Glover. And John Glover was our ex road manager of Spencer Davies Group, who would since become the road manager of Traffic for Chris Blackwell. So he was working for Island Records. And he had come over with Spooky Tooth, who we were trying to break in America. And I said to him, he was going home. He'd finished his tour and they were going home the next day. And I said to him, oh God, I feel so bad. I said, I've just had it. I've just got to go home. And I said, I've got to go up to this place, Woodstock. And he said, look, he said, I tell you what, he said, if you like, you take Spooky Tooth home, right? And I'll take Joe up to this thing in Woodstock. Of course, he went to Woodstock and I missed it. And the amazing story of Woodstock. There you go. How these things, how you see just how a little thing in a day changes. And there you go. And he got the history of Woodstock and I completely missed it. I was on the flight home.
And Clive Selwood says he went to Woodstock with Jack Holtzman, but they only got as far as the gate and just watched it from the end, and everybody hated it, he said, until the film came out when everybody decided actually they'd really, really enjoyed it.
Yeah, well,
he said everybody at the time hated it.
Yeah, because it was a nightmare there. I, with Joe, I'd been to two or three of these things on the West Coast, and they were nightmares. I mean, this business of LSD, they used to fill great wine flagons with LSD and wine. And guys used to walk through the crowd, right, pouring with these big flagons on their shoulder, pouring it into plastic cups for people and giving it to them, right? I mean, they had no idea what they were doing, you know. And, you know, I never got caught out by this. I got caught out later. But backstage, we could see the Red Cross tent, you know, and there were serious troubles. But you couldn't stop these people out there. You know, it was completely out of order and out of control. And but it was sort of frightening at the same time. But when you'd been there and done it, you kind of came away going, we're here, that was great. But actually, when you were there, it was a bit worrying. And of course, we didn't have to join the queues to get in. You know, we flew in by helicopter, you know, and flew out by helicopter. But the thing was, these helicopter pilots were wandering out to watch the bands, and you were going, please don't drink this stuff. You're off.
I have to go.
Yeah. I've got, is it 12?
Just about.
Yeah, so, I got to go at 12:30.
We're about to finish anyway. Forever and ever with these sorts of things, because I find them really interesting. But
well, we've got another 10-15 minutes.
That's perfect then. So so CBS, so Terence Trent D'Arby, Sade you mentioned earlier. Did you, who signed Sade, or how did it work? Did you sign? Signing is one of those lovely misnomers, isn't it, about record companies signing. I signed so-and-so. Well, I've got Briggsy somewhere talking about, I don't have the rights to sign anybody. Oh, he's trying to sign you too. He said, I didn't have the rights to sign anybody, obviously. And I made the mistake of telling McGuinness that, no, that deal was too expensive. And McGuinness tries to lamp him, you know, and all the rest of it. So if you're head of A&R, you sign everything, and then who brings you somebody like Sade?
Yeah, well, what happens is that in a large company, I had five people that worked for me, five A&R staff, who I bought in. So first and foremost, to do my job properly, I've got to pinpoint the right people to do the job. So I've got a staff. And their job is to go out there and find things. And then they would say to me, I found this really interesting act. Will you come and have a look? And sometimes I would go and say, yeah, I don't really see this. Are you sure? And if they really, really felt strongly about it, they'd persuade me. They'd say, look, you know, really, just listen to this song if you hadn't heard that one. And come and see them again next week. They weren't quite as great tonight as they were before. Come and see them again. And if they really, really wanted the act, they would convince you. And you'd say, OK, you know, you feel strongly, you've got a vision of where they go, let's take them. And that's how you signed acts. So your team brought in the act. they needed to speak to me about making sure that the deal was right, and I had to make sure with my boss, Oberstein, that the deal was right. And he would want to make sure that his A&R staff and team knew exactly what they were going to do with this act. If you just signed them on a whim, you know, he'd be most unhappy. And I'd be most unhappy if somebody wanted to sign an act because, you know, it's your mate or whatever. You know, you've got to have a vision and a view on where the act is going, what, and you know, silly little simple things like, okay, out of all these songs that we've got here, which do you think is the first record that they should release? Who do you think should produce it? Should they do it themselves, or do they need, you know, a big name producer to do it? Or, you know, do you have a vision of where it's going? And if you have that vision, even if I'm not 100% certain that this is the right act, this, we'll go with it. We'll go with it.
Did you get the rest? Did you have to get the rest of the company involved? Did you have to get marketing involved?
You would. Yeah.
Before you'd sign an act?
No, never. Or just me and the chairman or managing director and the A&R person were the three key people in terms of signing the act. So all those acts came through me. I could have stopped any one of them if I'd have wanted to. And I think I didn't get the Sade thing straight away because actually she was the backing singer with her band. She wasn't the lead singer. And I went to some gig somewhere with Annie Roseberry, who was one of my A&R people. And Annie said, she's got such a lovely voice, da-da-da-da-da, and the singer's doing something else, and I can't remember all of that. And so I kind of said, well, look, you know, you get the girl to go in and cut the songs with her singing and not the bloke singing, and we'll listen to it then. And, of course, Annie organised that, and took them into, I don't even remember anything about that, took them somewhere and made a little demo and things, and we got the demo. And of course you listen to the demo with Sade singing the song that she'd written and you go, wow, you know, I didn't spot that first time, but the girl Annie spotted it first time, my A&R person. And that's how you have to run an A&R department. You have to, A, make sure they really believe, and B, you have to support them when they really believe, and give them every chance you can to prove what they see and what they hear. And then you can sell that to the rest of the company, you know. And then once the music starts to get going, then you start getting people from the company, the pluggers and the press people, and say, come down to this gig and have a look at this gig, you know, way before things are ready. And you start to get the company, people in the company interested too. And that's how the record companies would be run. And you know, those people wouldn't come unless they believed in you and believed that you'd got something. You try to tell people going out at night and you take them to three or four bad gigs. Right? They won't come again. So when you say to people, come and have a look at this group, they're really good, they've got to go away feeling they've had an evening's entertainment that they've enjoyed, else they're not going to come next time because you're not paying them by the hour to come. You know, they come because it's part of their job, you know, but necessary, they don't have to come, you know. So getting things right, even with inside your own company, was very important, else the thing wouldn't have any motivation, it wouldn't have any momentum. So all those things are very important.
So what do you think the most successful signing, what were you most pleased with at CBS then?
I don't know.
It doesn't work that way, no.
Never works that way. anything that became successful was wonderful, because you know, you only get success. I don't know. I bet it's about 1 in 10 now. So you could sign 10 artists, and only one of them would make success. We had at one stage a fantastic success rate. We're about 1 in 4, you know, of every act that we were signing. You know, we were getting a breakthrough with. but, you know, that doesn't last. And, you know, usually, however hard you try, some acts are just in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Did you do the Wombles or not?
No, they were before my time.
Okay. Sorry, I collect stories on... Oh, what are your memories of Eel Pie Island? I'm just sort of half doing an Eel Pie Island project, and you said you played there earlier. Do you remember anything about it?
No, just getting across to it. No, nothing. Just a gig. Just sweaty, horrible... I can't even remember what the dressing rooms were like.
When you say getting across to it, what do you mean?
I mean, just getting to it. I mean, I just found it was a weird place. Do you know, now I don't think I could get there. If you said to me, take me to where Eel Pie Island was, I don't think I'd know how to get there from here. I'm not sure exactly where it is now. But I don't remember a lot about it. It was just another sweaty gig in London.
That's all right. That in itself is interesting, because inevitably... You know, now, I live quite relatively nearby. So
where is it?
It's Twickenham.
It is in Twickenham.
And so I sort of am half playing with... Because it's one of those legendary gigs. And,
yeah.
And you sort of half play with this, I'll do a... And I know various people that... And there's a blues club down there that a mate of mine runs, and, you know...
It's still there, is it?
No, not there. Yeah. That's long since gone. Yeah. But in the high street, there's a blues club. That,
oh, I see.
And all of that. And I sort of go, yeah, I'll do a programme on the Eel Pie. Yeah, you know. So what would you regard as your most rock and roll moment? What's the moment of... just utter madness as you look back on it all.
I don't know. I think my rock and roll moment is that I've drunk too much coffee.
Okay.
I'm going to go. I can't... I don't really remember... I mean, I suppose the only real rock and roll moment I had was being wandered through the streets of New York completely acid-blown. But I was... Right from the very beginning, well, certainly when I first came into the business and first met Chris Blackwell and first went into the record companies and started to get involved in London and the business, I suddenly found that I was not as educated as the people that I was dealing with. I wasn't as confident as the people that I was dealing with, and in some cases probably not even as brave as some of the people that I was dealing with. And I wanted to make sure that I stayed in this business, and all around me were people that were better than me. And I was just a secondary modern school kid who failed his 11 plus. I didn't go to university. I'd never made a speech in my life. I'd never, you know, I'd never done anything. I'd never even been into a restaurant until we went on the road with the Spencer. I'd never been in a restaurant. Never. And so I was surrounded by these smart London people, and I wanted to make a go. But then I noticed something. I noticed that these smart London people often had an Achilles heel. They were either so smart that they didn't work hard enough, or they thought they were so clever that they got stoned out of their brains a lot. And I thought, if I work harder than you and I don't get stoned, I've got a chance of keeping in the race. And it was the only thing that I had. I didn't have their education and stuff. And so I decided, funnily enough, after getting blasted out of my head on acid and realising what a complete useless mess that I had been, and blew my chance to go to Woodstock, I thanked God that that had happened early in my career, because I came home to Britain and I thought, I'm going to beat this. And the way I'm going to beat it is, I'm going to stay clean, sober, and I'm going to work really, really hard, because I'm going to be fit. And so I stayed fit, clean, sober, and worked really hard, and found that that was enough to keep me up in the race. And so I didn't do anything stupid. When the stupidity started, I kind of just slipped out of the back, you know, and let them get on with it. And I never got involved in being part of the bands that I'd signed and was involved. You know, I always kind of kept them at a sort of an arm's length. And I used to have a phrase I used to say to people, you know, I'm not your friend, you know, I'm not your lover, I'm your doctor. You know, I will deal with all the most personal things about your career, right? But like a doctor, I will deal with those personal things at arm's length, right? Not like a friend or a lover or a family member. We're not family, you know, we're just at that arm's length. And in fact, I found that a good way of dealing with people, because when people understood that, you know, and there were lots of A&R guys who became great friends with their act, or married their bloody act, or had sex with their act, or whatever it might be, you know, and all that does is put off the other acts that you deal with, right? You can't do that. And I found that that was the only way I could keep in the race. And that was my way of keeping in the race. And I learnt it very early on in New York, having gotten caught out, realising that that was all stupid. And it worked for me, you know. So I didn't have any other rock and roll moments after that. I made sure that I didn't. My acts had millions of them, right? But I conveniently nipped out of the door just before it all kicked off, you know.
Okay, last question then. Who was the best industry person you worked with?
I think I'd have to give that to Maurice Oberstein. I suppose Chris Blackwell. I only worked with two people. I worked with Chris Blackwell and Maurice Oberstein. That was it. I only did three jobs in the music industry. I did the Spencer Davis Group, worked for Chris Blackwell, worked for CBS, that then became Sony. CBS was bought out by Sony. And in my 35 years, or more than that, I can't remember, something like that, 35 years in the record industry, I only did three jobs. So the two bosses that I had were very well-known bosses. I mean, Chris Blackwell, goes without saying. And he was very much an entrepreneur in every way. But I think Maurice Oberstein wins it because he had something else going for him. He had a flamboyancy that was absolutely perfect for the period of time that we lived through. He was a great leader, and he did it in a very flamboyant style. And people loved him, but he was also very, very tough and hard. And he would face up to that toughness. And he would if he didn't think that you were pulling your weight, he would chase you with a cricket bat. You know, he was unbelievable. Whereas Chris Blackwell would often get other people to nudge people out of the way. He couldn't quite face them and say, "You're no bloody good, get out." You know, he'd get somebody else to do it. But Oberstein, for all his flamboyancy, he used to wear fantastic hats when he made speeches and do crazy things. He you know, was not afraid, you know, to really, you know, tell people where they stood. And I think people loved him for that. He was a bizarre character, but he worked for a bizarre industry.
It was a bizarre industry that Eric, we'll stop. I'll let you crack on, or
taking the Clash down to see Glyn Johns, the famous record producer who did the Eagles and all this kind of thing, you know, really taking the Clash to a different level, right? I mean, this was like making Clash Americana, this was. And I took them all down to the fucking Glyn Johns' house, and he lived in this beautiful house, mansion down in Surrey somewhere, with a gated drive. Long gated drive, and we got to the gate, and we got out of our car to open the gate, and he rode down on a fucking horse, right? He rode down on horseback. Well, you can imagine what they thought. And he's so pompous, and he's very, very tough, Glyn Johns, and he's boss. He's a real boss, and you know. He kind of looked down at him from the horse, you know, and you're thinking, you know, what are they sussing out about this guy? And he was saying things like, you know, I'm not going to stand any nonsense from you guys. You know, if you're going to start playing around doing this, that's it. You listen to me. I know what I'm doing. And I'm still sort of edging back, you know, and I think, oh my God. But, you know, the interesting thing was, of course, he was so strong and so pointed that they actually liked him, right? In the end, they kind of muttered and won. I can't remember we ever went in the house in the end. I think the whole meeting took place at the gate and he was on the horse. I can't remember going into the house at all, because I can remember the frontage, but I can't remember the house. So I don't think we went in. The whole meeting was done at the bloody gate and we went home again. As it happened, we couldn't work with him. They were prepared to have a go with him in the end. I was still kind of going, go on, give it a try as we were going back. But they did like him. I thought they were going to lynch him. But they actually really liked him. And he would have been ideal for them. But this was all about, you know, they were massive in the UK. And the Americans couldn't get them going properly. They did in the end. But they couldn't get them going properly. And, you know, they were saying to me, you've got to find another way. You know, these, you know, their stuff would sound like classic rock and roll, you know, if it had, you know, proper production values. So that was the idea, to cut an album that was really more American. And as it happened, it didn't work out. But, you know, it's, you know, all that was, right, was a bloody painful day where you drove all the way down there with this bunch of moaning bastards, you know, and all the way back trying to convince them to improve their career. And, you know, you're dragging them through mud. And you get home and all you say is, bloody awful day that was, you know, and you want to forget it, you know. You've got somebody really nice to deal with tomorrow, like Barbara Dixon. So, oh, at least speak to Barbara, have a nice cup of tea.